Good morning, students. Welcome to Narayana Live Classes. Today we are going to see the solutions of Class 7 Physics assignment, which was provided to you on 13th of June. Let us start. So our first question is, what makes object visible? Again, I'll repeat the question. What makes object visible? Basically, the question is, how do we see different objects? Now, a light from a distant source falls on an object and it gets reflected from that object. Now, when these reflected light rays falls on our eyes, that's when the object becomes visible. Let us understand this process with the help of a simple diagram. So, let us say I have an object here, any random object. And I have a distant light source. Let us say a bulb or a tube light or a sun. Anything. And when the light rays from this light source fall on this object, it gets reflected. And when these reflected light rays fall on the eye of an observer, like this, the object becomes visible. So basically, the phenomena of reflection is used in making things visible. So the answer to this question is, objects are visible only when light reflected from them reaches our eyes. Let's underline the terms, light reflected from them reaches our eyes. This is the important part. I hope the solution is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Question number two, what is reflection of light? Now, just now we spoke about reflection in our first question. Basically, what is this reflection? Now, light from any source, when it falls on an opaque surface or a translucent surface, there's a chance that it bounces back to the same medium. Again, I'm repeating, when a light from a distant source falls on an opaque or a translucent surface, some of the light will bounce back to the same medium. If it is translucent, some of the light will enter the medium, and some of the light will bounce back to the same medium. And if it is an opaque surface, the entire light which is falling on the surface, it will bounce back to the same medium. Let us draw the diagram. For example, this is my any opaque surface, let us say, and light from a distant source, if it falls, if it is incident on the surface, it will bounce back to the same medium. So this bouncing back of light is known as reflection. So the answer to this question is, bouncing back of light ray after hitting any surface is known as reflection of light. Let us underline the term bouncing back of light. Now, if the medium is transparent, there will be no bouncing back of light. The light will completely pass through the medium. So in that case, we cannot observe reflection of light. I hope the point is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Question number three is, why we are not able to see the candle flame through a bent pipe? Again, I repeat my question. Why we are not able to see the candle flame through a bent pipe? Now here we'll recollect one of the important properties of light. That is, light always travels in a straight line. Light always travels in a straight line. Now, I have taken two situations here. In the first case, the boy is trying to observe the candle flame with the help of a straight pipe. Whereas in the next case, the boy is trying to observe the candle flame with the help of a bent tube or a bent pipe. Now, in the first case, what will happen? The light from this flame will travel in a straight path and it will reach to the eye of an observer. So, this boy can easily observe the flame of the candle. In the next case, what is happening, the light from this candle flame will enter the pipe and it will get obstructed somewhere here. The light will not change its path, the light will not bend like this and it will reach the observer. This cannot happen because the light has to travel in a straight line. That's why the complete answer to this question is, we are not able to see the candle flame through a bent pipe because the light travels along the straight line. Because the light travels along the straight line. Let us underline the term, light travels along the straight line. Very important. I hope the point is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Now, before moving further, before going to our next question, I just wanted to recollect some of the points regarding spherical mirrors. In your class or in your light chapter, you might have come across the term spherical mirrors. And you might have also studied there are two types of spherical mirror. One is convex mirror, another one is concave mirror. Now, what is convex mirror basically? Let us try to draw a diagram. This is my spherical surface and this is the silvered part of my mirror, let us say. So, the other surface will be the reflecting surface. This will be my reflecting surface. So, if the reflecting surface of a spherical mirror is bulged outwards, if the reflecting surface of a spherical mirror is bulged outwards, such mirrors are known as convex mirrors. Such mirrors are known as convex mirrors. Now, there are certain important properties of the images formed by a convex mirror. Let us list out those properties. The image formed by convex mirror is always virtual and erect. What do you mean by virtual images? The images which cannot be obtained on the screen are known as virtual images. These images can be observed only inside the mirror. They cannot be obtained on the screen. One very good example of virtual image I can give you is that in your day-to-day life, you observe yourself in the mirror. The image which you see of yourself is a virtual image. That image you cannot obtain on the screen. Similarly, the image formed by a convex mirror is always virtual image, and this image is erect. Erect means upright. Next important property is the image is diminished. Now, what do you mean by diminished? That means it is smaller in size. Compared to object. As you can see here, I have taken a diagram of a convex mirror. I have taken a photo. Now in that you can see the image of the candle is smaller as compared to the actual candle itself. And the image is formed inside the mirror. That's why we can call it as a virtual image. Also, it is erect. So these properties of the convex mirror, the image formed by the convex mirror, are very important. We should remember these properties. Let us proceed further to the next point, which is concave mirror. Now, if in a spherical mirror, if the reflecting surface is bulged inwards, then such a mirror is known as concave mirror. As you can see here, the reflecting surface is the one which is bulged inwards. Such a mirror is known as concave mirror. Now, concave mirror has an ability to produce both type of images, the real image and the virtual image. Now, real image is the one which you can obtain on the screen, whereas virtual image, as I've discussed, you cannot obtain it on the screen. Now, here I have taken the picture of a concave mirror producing images. As you can see, the image of this candle flame is formed on the screen behind it. So, seeing this, we can guess that, obviously, this image is a real image. Also, it is an inverted image, as you can see. The concave mirror has also an ability to produce virtual image in this case. In this case, the image is virtual, whereas in this case, the image is real. In this case, in the second case, where the concave mirror is forming a virtual image, you can see that the image is also enlarged. Enlarged. Enlarged means it is bigger in size as compared to the actual object itself. This property of concave mirror is used in many places. So I hope the concept of spherical mirrors is a bit clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. What type of image, question number four, what type of image does the outer side of the spoon show? What type of image does the outer side of spoon show? Now, the outer side of the spoon acts like a convex mirror. As you can see, the reflecting surface is bulged outwards. The reflecting surface is bulged outwards. That's why we can call it like a, we can say that it acts like a convex mirror. Now, just now we saw the properties of a convex mirror. The image formed by a convex mirror is always erect, virtual, and diminished. Diminished as in it is smaller in size as compared to that of the object. So that's why the answer to this question is the outer surface of the spoon acts like a convex mirror. And the image formed by the convex mirror is erect, virtual, and smaller in size than the object. Just for your understanding, I have taken the image of the spoon, outer surface of the spoon. The boy is observing his image on the outer surface of the spoon. As you can clearly see that the image is diminished. Also, the image is formed inside the spoon itself, like inside the mirror. That's why we can call it as a virtual image. Also, the size of the image is smaller as compared to the size of the actual boy itself. That means the image is diminished. I hope the solution to this question is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Question number five. What happens when a light falls on the mirror? Again, I repeat my question. What happens when a light falls on the mirror? Now, we all know that mirror is a highly polished surface. Also, it is completely opaque. Now, when a light falls on a highly polished surface like a mirror, there will be a phenomena of reflection taking place. That means when a light falls on the mirror, it will bounce back and the mirror will change the direction of the light. It will change the direction of light. This change in direction or this bouncing back of light is known as reflection. So the answer to this question which I have written is a mirror changes the direction of light that falls on it. The change in direction by the mirror is called as reflection of light. I hope the solution is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. If you want, you can also draw a diagram to this. You can draw a mirror. And you can draw a light source here. And the light which is falling from this light source will get reflect. It will reflect it back to the same medium. It will bounce back to the same medium. That means its direction is changing in this case. And this change in direction by the mirror is known as reflection. I hope the point is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Question number six is, what is virtual image? Give one situation where virtual image is formed. I repeat my question. What is virtual image? Give one situation where virtual image is formed. Just now, when we saw the properties of the image formed by a convex mirror, we commented that virtual image is the one which cannot be obtained on the screen. So the image which cannot be obtained on the screen, the image which cannot be obtained on the screen is known as virtual image. And one more example I gave, in a day-to-day life, we use plane mirrors. We see ourselves in the plane mirrors. The image which we see is nothing but the virtual image. So the example to this question you can give is, the plane mirror always forms a virtual image. I hope the point is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Question number 7. Give one use of concave and convex mirror. Again, I repeat my question. Give one use of concave and convex mirror. Now, let us recollect the properties of the image formed by the concave mirror first. Now, as we discussed, concave mirror has an ability to produce both type of images, the real image and virtual image. But when a concave mirror produces a virtual image, the image is enlarged image. That means the image is greater. The size of the image is bigger as compared to the size of an object. So we get a nice, clear, big picture of an object when we use a concave mirror. So this property of the concave mirror is mainly used by dentists to check our teeth, because they get a clear enlarged picture. They get a clear enlarged image of our teeth on that concave mirror. Also, one more example which I can give is, usually men use concave mirror for shaving because they can get a enlarged picture, enlarged image of their face while shaving, which is useful for them. So the example which I have used is, concave mirror are used by dentists to see the teeth. Whereas if you recollect the properties of the image formed by the convex mirror, there we discussed that convex mirror always forms an image which is virtual, which is erect, and which is diminished. Diminished means it is smaller. The image is smaller as compared to the size of an object. Now, this property of this mirror is used in the rear view mirrors of the cars. As we know that when we are driving, we need to have a clear picture of the area behind us. All the vehicles which are coming behind us, we need to have the clear picture of them. So that now we know that the convex mirror forms a diminished image. Now, due to this property, I can have the image of a larger area behind me when I'm driving. That's why this property of a convex mirror is used as a rear view mirror in the vehicles. I hope the point is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Which type of mirror can form a real image? Now, we have studied three types of mirror till now: plane mirror, concave mirror, and convex mirror. And we saw that the plane mirror always forms a virtual image. The images formed by the plane mirror cannot be obtained on the screen. Also, convex mirror, they also form the virtual image. Their images also cannot be obtained on the screen. So the one mirror which we have studied, which forms the real image, is the concave mirror. So the mirror which forms the real image is the concave mirror. Also agreed, concave mirror has ability to produce both type of images, real and virtual. This we should not forget. But it can form real images. The question is, which type of mirror can form a real image? The answer is, concave mirror can form real images. Let us proceed further to the next question. Okay. The question is, why the word ambulance is painted left, right, inverse on the vehicle? If you are confused with the word left, right, inverse, the image is in front of you. The ambulance is written in this form on the vehicle. Now, what is the reason for this is, there's something called as lateral inversion of the image. When we see ourselves in the mirror, we say that our image is laterally inverted. That means when we lift our left hand, our image lifts its right hand. So due to this lateral inversion of image, the ambulance is written in this manner on the vehicle, because the person who is driving in front in the front vehicle, he can clearly see the ambulance written on the vehicle, so that he can give the he can clear the way for the ambulance during emergency. So the answer to this question which I have written is, when a driver of a vehicle in front of the ambulance looks into his rear view mirror, what he will get? He will get a laterally inverted image of the word ambulance. So he will read the ambulance written in the proper manner. So he can read the ambulance written on it quickly and give way to it during emergency. Okay. I hope the point is clear. Let us proceed further to the next question. Question number 10. What is the focal length of a plane mirror? Again, I repeat, what is the focal length of a plane mirror? Now, let us try to understand first what is focal length. Now, you might have done this fun experiment if you had a concave mirror with you. Now, using a concave mirror, we can focus the rays of sun, on a distant object. Let us say a paper. We can focus all the rays of sun on a paper. And we notice that the paper instantly starts burning. Not instantly, after some time, it starts burning. Why? Because we are focusing all the rays of sunlight, all the light which is coming from sun on that one particular spot on paper. This particular spot where all the light is focused is known as focus of the mirror. And the distance between this focus from the mirror, the distance of this focus point from the mirror is known as focal length. Whereas if you take a plane mirror, and if you try to focus the rays of sunlight on a particular point, you won't be able to do it. Whereas if the sunlight which is falling on the plane mirror, they will reflect back and again they will move in the parallel direction. The sunlight which is falling on the mirror, again, after reflection, the reflected rays will also be parallel. They will not be focused on one particular point. So that's why we say that the focal length of a plane mirror is infinite. As you can see, all the parallel rays falling on our plane mirror, after reflection, the reflected rays are also parallel. They don't meet at a particular point. We say that they meet at infinity. Parallel rays meet at infinity. That's why the focal length of the plane mirror is considered to be infinite. I hope all the solutions are clear to you. Thank you. Thank you so much.